Hello and welcome to the Legislative Journal for February 2023 with State Representative Greg Vitali from the 166th Legislative District representing Delaware County. Well, with a new governor comes some new administrations, some cabinet choices, some new secretaries. What have you heard and what's going on?
Right, very excited about Governor Shapiro. I actually served with Josh for 8 years in the State House, so I know him personally. I can tell you he's an extremely bright person, a very good orator, strategic thinker. I just knowing him, he's a person who has been successful at everything he's done. He was very well thought of in the State House. And in fact, when we had the trouble with a speaker many years ago, the Democrats and Republicans not being able to agree as we have right now, Josh was instrumental in doing a deal to get one of the members from Philadelphia, Denny O'Brien, to be speaker. So he's really strong with regard to issues like that. I suspect he is going to be an outstanding governor. I think he's got off starting line very fast. He's been, you know, very active with things he's been doing. You know, one of the things I've been following, obviously, is as the chair of the Environmental Committee, is the environmental front. And he appointed a very solid person as the Secretary of the Department of Environmental Protection, Richard Negrin. Rich has a very solid managerial background. I believe he was managing director of the city of Philadelphia. He was a former Philadelphia prosecutor. Worked most recently for ComEd, which is a power company, which will give him a good background in some of the energy challenges that the department will be facing. You know, we've talked many times before on this show about things like the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, REGI, you know, climate change generally, and how Pennsylvania is a major greenhouse gas producer with its, you know, oil and gas reserves, and how with that fossil fuel reserve comes the responsibility of addressing climate change. And the fact that Rich Negrin has this experience in the power sector will, I think, give him a moderating influence on this. You know, I've reached out to him and to sit down with him and give him my thoughts on things. And he was very receptive, responded. I think he responded like 10:30 at night the day I asked him. No, so he's also a person with a work ethic. And so I look forward to sitting down with him to talk about energy issues, talk about, you know, the Department of Environmental Protection. Generally, I think one of the things I would talk to him about would certainly be the chronic understaffing of the Department of Environmental Protection. You know, one of the things I've been working on for many years in dealing with the department, I've really tried to be an advocate for that department. They have been chronically understaffed, and I would submit intentionally understaffed. I believe the conservatives in Harrisburg simply do not want a Department of Environmental Protection that has you know, adequate staffing in the air program and the water program and the Chesapeake Bay program. They simply don't want that sort of oversight over, you know, industry, over the oil and gas program and other industry. They don't want it, and they have been, frankly, intentionally keeping that understaffed. And, you know, that has persisted. It's frankly, it's even persisted during the Wolf administration. I think despite, you know, a lot of documentation as to how we are failing in various metrics with regard to protecting the environment. So I'd like to sit down with Rich Negrin and give my thoughts. I have spoken, for example, on this issue with people from the Department of Environmental Protection, and honestly, you know, they know the problem, and privately, I'm sure they will convey it too. But the importance to convey that particular issue now to Rich Negrin and Josh Shapiro is as follows. Josh will be presenting his budget to the General Assembly on March 7th. And his budget is a sort of a list of priorities, almost like a opening salvo in the negotiations. You know, we have a divided government, you know, Senate's Republican, House is barely Democratic, and the governor's office is Democratic. So, you know, the budget proposal that Josh Shapiro puts out there, it's almost like an opening negotiation position. And I think the problem is, and I've seen this with previous governors, is if you don't put a good opening position out there, in other words, for example, if Governor Shapiro would propose a status quo DEP budget that simply proposes to fund it at its current woefully inadequate level, that's as good as it's going to get. I mean, when negotiations start, they're not getting any better than that. So the key, I think, for Governor Shapiro and Rich Negrin and others is to sort of put out there the budget they would like to see enacted, which is substantially larger than the current budget. And if they fail to do that in their March 7th budget proposal, it really is kind of spells, you know, another year of underfunding for the DEP. So, you know, one thing to keep our eye out for is what the governor does on March 7th. And that proposal will be sort of followed up, as it always is, with budget hearings. Now, this year, both the governor's proposal and the hearings are sort of moved into the future a little more than normal because it's a new governor. You know, the budget hearings don't start until maybe mid-March and go through early April. And at that point, the various, the appropriations committees of the House and Senate will be interrogating the various secretaries of the various departments, be it education, transportation, the environment, and on and on, as to the budget proposals. The role I play in that, assuming I am reappointed as chair of the Environmental Committee, is to be given the opportunity to interrogate the DEP secretary, which would be Rich Negrin, and the DCNR, the Department of Conservation and Natural Resource Secretary, Cindy Dawn, who is returning. Again, she served as Department of Conservation and Natural Resource Secretary under Governor Wolf, did an outstanding job there. So my role with regard to budget hearings will be to, you know, bring up pertinent points with regard to you know, those budgets, and of course the funding levels of those budgets will be sort of front and center. So I, you know, from the executive perspective, I'm looking forward to working with the governor. My hope is that some of the issues that we worked on last term, like the regional greenhouse gas initiative, like the regulations relating to emissions, methane, VOCs from the oil and gas industry, those regulations will continue to move forward. I know there's a lot of pressure in the opposite direction from the oil and gas industry, the Marcellus Coalition, and frankly, unfortunately, with regard to some of these environmental laws and regulations, we've talked about this before, but increasing pressure from the building trades, who seem to be looking at environmental issues simply through the narrow lens of their union jobs. So my hope is that the governor will stand firm on things like enacting REGI, the VOC regs, proper funding of DEP, and other things we're doing. I think another issue is the hydrogen hub, the issue of there's federal money out there for Pennsylvania to establish a hydrogen hub, which is sort of a collection of existing and new infrastructure designed to create hydrogen as a future fuel source. As we talked before, this can be done in a very climate-friendly manner, in a way that we are really reducing CO2 impacts. Work can be done in a very damaging way that simply perpetuates the natural gas industry and does not reduce CO2 emissions. So how we approach the hydrogen hub issue is another, I think, front and center issue for the Shapiro administration, Secretary Negrin, and others that we'll be watching closely. So yeah, I think the governor has a lot on its plate, and we in the state house have to get our act together in the upcoming weeks so we can be a really viable partner in this.
Well, you talked about divided government. Where have the latest elections left us, especially after these most recent special elections? What does this mean for the House?
Well, I mean, this is very exciting because I think just to give a running start to all this, the House Democrats did surprisingly well in the November 8th, 2022 elections. We weren't expected to jump into the majority, but we in fact won a bare majority. We won 102 of the 203 seats. So we won by simply one vote. Now, the problem there is that right before the election, one of the Democrats, Tony DeLuca, succumbed to cancer, but was elected posthumously. Two other winning state candidates also were not able to serve. Summer Lee, who is running concurrently as a U.S. Congresswoman, was successful and resigned the state house after the first of the year to serve in Congress. And then finally, Austin Davis was also running concurrently, both for the state house and the lieutenant governor. Obviously, he won on the Shapiro ticket and left too. So that brought us down to, what was that, 98 seats. And so we functionally were not in the majority, even though we won a majority of seats on election day. Now, what ensued when we came back to session after the first of the year, the first Tuesday in January, as the Constitution requires, what happened there was what we generally do on that day is we elect a speaker and enact House rules and begin the process of reorganizing the State House chamber. The House Democratic Caucus collectively elected Joanna McClinton as the one, our choice as speaker, and she would historically have become the first woman speaker and in fact the first Black woman speaker. There was the normal intrigue and hijinks on election day, and essentially the Republican, I'll call it minority, reached out across the aisle to several Democratic members. The deal was that if one of these backbencher Democratic members would agree to become an independent rather than a Democrat, the Republicans would throw their weight behind them to elect them as speaker. And I think that offer was made to at least three House Democrats, and the one House Democrat who said yes to that was Mark Rossi, who just by chance sits next to me on the House floor, so we chit chat all the time, and I know Mark pretty well. Mark accepted. One reason he accepted was because his burning issue in the State House is compensation for people who, as children, were abused sexually. He as a 13-year-old boy, was abused by a Roman Catholic priest, now deceased. And his burning issue in the legislature has been to allow victims compensation. Now, the problem is there is a statute of limitations for these claims. They have to be brought within a certain amount of years, and if not, you lose your ability to bring them. And that statute of limitations has closed for many of these victims. What Mark Rossi's burning issue was to change the Constitution to allow a two-year window for these victims to make their claims. And I think he took the deal to put himself in a position to make sure that constitutional amendment is passed. On the substance of the issue, I personally have some concerns, because I think what we may be voting on when we come back would be very broad in scope and also subject our public schools to claims which at least one public interest group, I think the Susquehanna group, has estimated would cost our public schools billions of dollars if this were to happen. So Rossi took the deal, and he is now speaker, has been speaker. With regard to these three special elections, all of which are in Allegheny County, the Democrats won all three. So the Democrats now have, once these seats are certified, which should happen on February 21st, will put the Democrats in that narrow majority. So the question, we should have, when we return to the floor on February 21st, 102 seats. What we expect to happen is, when we get back on the 21st, is to enact rules. House rules will allow us to get ourselves reorganized. We need to agree on rules. They are currently under discussion. Once they are agreed to, there will be a vote on them. Hopefully we'll get them passed on the 21st, 22nd of February, thereabouts. And then, then we will begin to reorganize. Committee chairman should be appointed, committee members should be appointed, and then we can get about the business of starting to introduce bills and refer bills to committee and get ourselves rolling. Now the question becomes, since Joanna McClinton was elected by the Democratic caucus as speaker, and Mark Rossi has fallen from favor among Republicans because it's alleged he did not keep his part of the deal by switching to independent, but remained as a Democrat. The question is, will he remain as speaker, or will he work with the Democrats to elect Joanna McClinton as speaker? That's an interesting question. I mean, he was actually quoted very recently in the Inquirer saying that he is going to, quote unquote, reassess his position as speaker. And it appears, reading between the lines, if in fact he gets his constitutional amendment approved, he very well may be willing to step aside for Joanna McClinton to be speaker. But that's all speculative. According to Rossi, he is simply going to take things, you know, quote unquote, one day at a time. So it's never dull in the state house, and looking forward to really kind of getting back to work and moving forward with a good environmental agenda.
Well, we'll get back to some of this house stuff probably a little later if we have time, but I did want to give people the opportunity. You have an upcoming Shred event. Could you tell people about what's going on in your district?
Yeah, sure. You know, it's funny because I not funny, but it was difficult to retain staff during COVID, and I kind of felt like our maybe staff had slipped a bit because we're down to just one staffer. But we're at full complement now. We have an excellent team hitting on all cylinders right now in the district office, and they took the initiative to schedule a shredding event for Saturday, April 29th from 10 to 1 at the Marple High School. We are working in conjunction with newly elected Radnor Representative Lisa Borowski, who's an excellent member of a new member of the legislature. She's doing very well. So, we're hoping that that is a success. There are actually multiple shredding events out there. As we were researching this, I know that they just seem very popular, and a lot of elected officials seem to be holding them. But we're going to add our name to the list and encourage people to participate if they have some documents they need to get rid of.
And then one more thing along with going on in your district, Scepter Senior ID key cards. I understand that some of them are starting to expire now.
Right. Yeah. During COVID, I believe, when you got a Scepter Senior ID card, which I actually did, I think they last 4 years, if I'm not mistaken. And excuse me, but because of COVID, SEPTA was basically saying, you know, if you have a card which on its surface appears to be expiring, it's going to continue to be good. And the reason there is they did not want people putting themselves in a situation where they're interacting with other people and getting themselves sick with COVID. So they suspended expiration. But since COVID has subsided a bit, the cards now in 2023 are in fact expiring. So if on the, excuse me, face of your card, it's going to expire this year, take that seriously And, you know, you have a couple of options there. One of your best option is to just come to our district office and we will help you process the renewal of that SEPTA senior ID.
Well, great. And I understand that there are actually some plans maybe coming to one of your satellite offices, or at least there may be news on the horizon in the future.
Right. So, we have our district office at Darby Manoa Roads in Havertown, and that's, we are there full time Monday through Friday. And we've also maintained a second satellite office. We have that in the basement of the Ardmore Library, which is both handicapped accessible and in a different population center. But because of redistricting, the Ardmore location is actually no longer in our district. That's in Low Marion Township. And we serve no longer serve Marion Township, Lower Marion Township, but we do serve Marple Township. So we have been in the process of scouting out a new location, and I think we have a winner, but I won't announce the location until we, you know, dot all the I's and cross all the T's. So what I anticipate in the upcoming weeks is our switching our satellite office from the Ardmore Library, who incidentally has been a great host, very courteous, has been helpful and cooperative in every way, switching from there to a location in Marple, which I think people will like. In fact, I kind of went on a little tour visiting our four final locations with my chief of staff yesterday, and I think we hit on a winner, but we want to, before we finalize it, just make sure everything is as it should be. So we'll be making that announcement soon.
Well, with only about a minute or two left, I'm just going to give you a chance to say kind of what you're going to be pushing for as the House comes into session, and take it away.
Well, I'm excited. I'm hoping that I am reappointed chair of the Environmental Committee. I expect to be. It's not a guarantee. But right off the bat, I will have the opportunity to set up some public hearings and put the spotlight on certain issues. And I think the first public hearing I intend to hold, which should be sometime in February. Early March, is just this whole DEP staffing issue. Bring some former staffers in there and some current staffers and actually finally use some newfound power, I hope. We'll keep our fingers crossed.
Well, State Representative Greg Vitali, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today.
Well, thank you for having me. Always a pleasure.